Okay, so good morning, everyone. We are recording now. And are there any questions or concerns from anything we have discussed so far? So we'll be switching to the new module today, coloring vertex colorings of graphs. But before that, I'll just wrap up planarity with an important point that may be relevant on assignment 3. And in general, to get a better understanding of minors. So, what I have stated here is the difficult direction of both Kurtowski's and Wagner's theorem. So, the difficult direction says that if you have a non-planar graph, then either the graph is a K5 or K33 subdivision in Kurtowski's case, or K5 or K33 minor in Wagner's theorem case. So these theorems are equivalent. One implies the other, without too much hard work, one can say. However, it's not immediate. What is clear is if you have a K5 or K33 subdivision, then you have a K5 or K33 minor. So Kurtowski's theorem implies Wagner's theorem much more immediately. We proved Wagner's theorem, and it's not clear why a K5 or K33 minor implies a K5 or K33 subdivision, right? So on the assignment 3, so let's say you want to prove that Wagner's theorem implies Kurtowski, right? I'm just looking at the difficult direction. Okay, so you take a non-planar graph, G is non-planar. So by Wagner's theorem, G has a K5 or K33 minor. Actually, let me write it separately. It has a K5 minor or a K33 minor. On the assignment, you will be showing that if there is a K33 minor, then there is a K33 subdivision. And the reason for this is that K33, the maximum degree of any vertex is 3, or at most 3. In this case, it is exactly 3. So, whenever that is the case, having a K33 minor, or for any graph which has maximum degree at most 3, it implies that you have a K33 subdivision. Maybe you have already convinced yourself of this, which is good. What the problem is, a K5 minor, because K5 has vertices of degree 4 or more, a K5 minor does not imply a K5 subdivision. However, you will be proving on the assignment that in this case, there is an interesting coincidence, I would like to say. It's either there is a K33 subdivision, so maybe I should write it differently. Either there is a K5 subdivision, or if you can't find a K5 subdivision, then that is because there is a K33. Well, in that case, there is a K33 subdivision. So you'll find one of these two. And so in both cases, you will have found a K5 subdivision or a K33 subdivision, and therefore it implies Kurtowski's theorem, right? So this is, I would say, non-trivial. It's clearly not obvious. And this will be on assignment 3. You'll also be proving this on assignment 3, but this is easy. Okay. And what I would like to tell you is about a different way of thinking about minors that will help you in proving this on the assignment. And in general, it is useful to have this more visual way of thinking about minors just to get a better understanding of what's going on, right? So the definition of minors that we covered, or the standard definition of minors, is a graph J is a minor of a graph G if you can obtain J from G by three operations. You can delete vertices, you can contract edges, you can delete edges. But this is not very visual, right? It's not clear. It's not very visually appealing definition. It's just verbose. So there is a more visual way of thinking about minors, which is the following. Supposing a graph G, so I'll give you the example of K5. Supposing a graph G has K5 minor. Then this is the more visual way of thinking about it. What you can do is you can visualize your graph as a cluster of, as five clusters. Each of these clusters represents a set of vertices in the original graph. So your graph G, you can partition its vertex set into these parts. Each of these is a connected subgraph. So we want that each G, the graph induced by Vi, is connected. For all I will write at least one. You will see in a minute why I'm writing this. Okay, so in this, in some sense, you want to think of this as being contraction. In the final graph, if you look at a vertex, which is a contraction vertex after doing a bunch of deletions and contractions, then every vertex will correspond to a connected subgraph in the original graph. Think of contracting one edge. If you contract one edge, then you get a single vertex. And this vertex corresponds to this subgraph, which is a connected subgraph. In the same sense, if you do repeated contractions and if you get a big vertex out of it, then that will correspond to a connected subgraph in the original graph. Okay, so I want you to think of this as corresponding to contraction of edges. We also need to take into account that we are allowing deletion of vertices. So what could happen is you may have to delete a bunch of vertices in the graph V0, and then you partition the graph into these connected pieces V1 to V5. Okay, so there is a so the graph has a partition, the vertex set of the graph has a partition V0, V1, V5, like this, such that the graph induced by all the parts from V1 to V5 are they are connected. V0 could just be any arbitrary set of vertices. And then you do your contractions. So that is shrinking each vertex into a single vertex, shrinking each V graph induced by Vi to a single vertex. And once you do that, you can delete some edges because that is the thing we have not yet accounted for. So shrink each I at least one into a single vertex, and you will get some graph H, resulting graph is H. And once you get H, you can take any spanning subgraph of H. So that will take care of deleting edges. And now let J be a spanning subgraph of H. So in the case of K5, what could happen is you could have some multiple edges when you do this operation. And you can throw away those multiple edges. If you want to think about simple graphs, you can take K5 minus one edge, and you can throw away any one edge from the graph H. Okay? So this is another way of thinking about minors. A graph J is a minor of a graph G if you can partition the vertex set of G into six parts in this case, because the graph J has five vertices. Right, so we have one part V0, which is basically vertices you just delete. All the other parts, they induce connected subgraphs in the original graph. And you are allowed to shrink each of these connected subgraphs into a single vertex. This corresponds to contraction of edges. And once you have done that, you get a graph H. And in H, you can throw away any additional edges that you don't care about to get your final graph J, which in this case is K5, right? So I can obtain K5 from G in this manner. That is equivalent to saying that K5 is a minor of the graph G. Okay, the fact that these two definitions are equivalent, I'll leave it as an exercise. You can write down a rigorous proof if you like, or you can convince yourself that these are equivalent if you don't want to write down a rigorous proof. Okay? So this is a more visual way of thinking about minors. And with this visual way of thinking about it, it's perhaps more clear that if a graph has a K5 as a minor, or any non-planar graph as a minor, then the whole graph must be minor, must be non-planar, right? So is it clear what this equivalent way of thinking is? So in our example, J is K5. So the graph has a K5 minor if and only if you have a partition like this. Right. So you first delete the set V0. Delete V0. And then you shrink each VI to a single vertex, the graph induced by VI to a single vertex. And then from the graph H, you delete some edges. Okay. So this is taking care of deletion of vertices. Perhaps I should write shrinking. This corresponds to contraction of edges. And finally, you're taking a spanning subgraph. So this is taking care of deletion of edges. Okay? Good. Are there any questions or concerns? Does this seem believable? Do you find this believable that the definition of minor that we discussed earlier is really the same as this one? Okay? So try to write down a rigorous proof of it as an exercise for yourself. But I'm not going to go into it. It's a bit of a boring exercise. Okay? Good. So if there are no questions regarding anything we have discussed so far in planarity, I would like to start the next module, which is coloring vertices of graphs, vertex colorings. And we'll start with planar graphs. All right. Okay, so how many of you have not heard of the four color theorem or conjecture or problem? If you haven't, then please write it in the chat box so that I know how much time to spend on it accordingly. But also just for curiosity, I'm just curious as to how many of you have heard of it and how many of you haven't heard of it ever. Okay. Seems like everyone's heard of it. Great. Nonetheless, let me say a bit more. Actually, okay. So if I were giving a historical course on graph theory, I'd probably start with the four color theorem. But since this is not the case, we are doing it in a different order. So since you have all heard of the four color theorem, I'll just be very brief. You can take any map in the world if you like, or any map. And the theorem says, or the conjecture back then says, that you may color the regions of the map in such a way that any two regions that share a border will get distinct colors. And you just need four colors to do this. For every single map in the world, you do not require more than four colors. Okay? And this is a conjecture. Well, it was a conjecture that led to a lot of developments in graph theory in the first 100 or so years of the subject. Okay? So it's a lot of topics in graph theory, including planarity, matchings that we will be studying later, edge colorings, vertex colorings, clearly, they all started because of the four color conjecture, because people were trying to prove the four color conjecture and there were lots of failed attempts. We will talk about two of those failed attempts. And these failed attempts also led to interesting discoveries and results. Okay, so back in 1852, I'm directly reading from Wikipedia, which is also essentially stated in Bondi Murthy. De Morgan, the very famous De Morgan's laws guys, he wrote in a letter that, well, basically he wrote the following, which I'll just highlight here. A student of mine, Guthrie, asked me today to give him a reason for a fact which I did not know was a fact and do not yet. He says that if a figure be anyhow divided and the compartments differently colored, so that figures with any portion of common boundary line are differently colored, four colors may be wanted, but not more. The following is his case in which four colors are wanted. Query, cannot a necessity for five or more be invented? Strange old English style of writing. Right, so basically what he's saying, so let me change the screen I'm sharing. All right, so back to our document. Essentially what he's saying is that you draw any figure and divide it into compartments like this. I don't know. Right? And now you have some regions, or if you like, faces. Then you can always color these regions with different colors so that whenever two regions share a border, like R1 and R2, they will get distinct colors, right? So the color of R1 should be different from color of R2. And what he's saying is that you can always do this using just four colors. There is no way to invent a situation where you're going to require five or more colors. Okay? And this is the famous four color conjecture. And it's fairly clear now that we have gone through planarity that you can just convert this into a graph. You can convert this into a planar graph. And all he is saying is that the faces of this planar graph, or plane graph in this case, can be, if I'm saying faces, I should say plane graph, can be colored, right? So I can put vertices everywhere like this. And now it's the same as saying that the faces of this plane graph can be colored in such a way so that any two faces that share a boundary get different colors. And the conjecture says that you don't need any more than four colors. Okay? Maybe I should also put vertices here. Doesn't matter. Actually, they were not necessary. I could have just put an edge. Whatever. Right? So this is the four color problem. So let's just state it. So what we are doing right now corresponds to sections 11.1 and 11.2 in the text. Okay? So let me put down some definitions. A K-face coloring of a plane graph is an assignment of K colors to its faces, right? So there is no restriction here. You can just color them any way you like. We will call the K-face coloring as a proper K-face coloring. It is proper. Although I'm pretty sure many times I'm not going to say proper, I'm just going to say face coloring. But anyways, let's just try being rigorous. If no two adjacent faces receive the same color? Okay. And we will say that the plane graph is k-face colorable if it has a proper k-face coloring. A plane graph G is k-face colorable if it has a proper k-face coloring. Okay. And the conjecture, I will put conjecture in double quotes because it is no longer a conjecture, it is a theorem. Four color conjecture, 4cc, says that every plane graph I'll put it in brackets without cut edges is four face colorable. Basically the point is that every planar map, so we didn't define a planar map, but you get the idea what a map is. And since we only care about graph theory, I won't write down a definition of a planar map. So every planar map corresponds to a plane graph without cut edges. That's why this is equivalent to saying that every graph without cut edges is four face colorable. Okay. What is the problem with cut edges? Well, if you have cut edges, one way of thinking about it is that you want to give two different colors to the two sides of the edge. So this edge here, this side should get a different color from this side, but because the two sides are the same face, you can't do that. Okay. Another way of thinking about it is, well, you can give them the same color because they are the same face. And in that case, the statement is true even without this parenthetical remark. Okay, so this parenthetical remark is not really that crucial, but we'll still keep it so that we can directly translate it to vertex colorings from face colorings. And you will see in a minute what I mean by that. Okay, so don't pay too much attention to this parenthetical remark. The statement is also true without it, depending on how you define colorings. Okay. So this conjecture was posed by Francis Guthrie or Frederick Guthrie, who are brothers, in 1852. I'll just say Guthrie. Okay. Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay. Are there any questions or concerns? Okay. If not, then let us observe very quickly that you can now, using duality, convert this into a vertex coloring problem, right? You just take the dual graph. I won't even draw everything, but it's fairly clear that coloring the original graph G, coloring its faces, is the same as coloring the vertices of the dual graph, so that any two adjacent vertices receive different colors. Right? We have spent a lot of time on duality, so this should be fairly clear. Right? The faces turn into vertices, and a cut edge will become a loop. Okay? And now it's clearer, because if you have a loop, then the two adjacent, the two vertices that are ends of the same edge, they cannot receive different colors because it is the same vertex, which is the end of both of these edges, right? So whenever we talk about vertex colorings, we are not going to allow loops, okay? And now it becomes clearer why we are not allowing cut edges in the plane graph version, in the face coloring version. Okay, so just so that they become exactly equivalent to each other. So this conjecture is equivalent to conjecture 11.3, which says that every planar graph, now I don't need an embedding because I'm going to talk about vertices instead of faces, without loops, is four vertex colorable. But we did not define vertex colorability. So let me just be lazy and state it as follows. So I'm going to go back to the same definitions, and I'm going to mark in red what I want to change. So now I don't need a plane graph. I'm going to define K vertex coloring for all graphs is an assignment of K colors to its vertices. Okay. And it is proper if no two adjacent vertices receive the same color. And a graph G is K vertex colorable if it has a proper K vertex coloring. Okay, so if you read the red stuff, then you will get the vertex coloring definitions. Okay, good. So that saves us some time, and hopefully the equivalence is clear by duality, right? Good. The advantage of this conjecture is that we don't need an embedding of the graph to discuss the conjecture, right? You can take any abstract graph. So long as it is planar, it has a planar embedding, the conjecture says that it is four vertex colorable. Okay. Typically, in graph theory text, including Bondi-Murthy, coloring generally refers to vertex coloring. So four vertex colorable is called four colorable. But I think I will stick to saying four vertex colorable because there's also going to be edge colorings. And I would rather just distinguish between these things than result in any confusion. Okay. So in the text, if you see four colorable, they are talking about vertex colorings. Good. So, as I said, this is conjecture 11.1, but it is not a conjecture. It is also a theorem. It's still common to refer to the four-color theorem as the four-color conjecture because for so many years it was a conjecture. People are just used to calling it a conjecture. All right. Good. So, let's go back quickly to the history. As we discussed, it was proposed in 1852 or before that, but the first written version that we are aware of is in 1852, right? All right. And it was proved in the 1970s, if I'm not mistaken, by Apple and Hacken. So that's about 120 years that it was open without any correct proof. But it's a very simple statement, right? It's doesn't require even if you look at the way De Morgan stated it in his letter, he doesn't even use any mathematical notation to explain the conjecture, right? It's something you can explain to a small kid. In fact, that is what I do at parties when I go to my relatives' parties. I don't think the adults appreciate it, but the kids like it, I think, right? So it's actually the case with many combinatorics problems that they're very easy to state, but a lot of them are actually quite difficult to prove. And the four-color theorem is perhaps the best example of that. It's so simple to state, and yet till today, I don't think there is a single graph theory course where you see the proof of the four color theorem, right? So we won't be seeing a proof of it. But let me tell you a bit about the history. So there were lots of incorrect proofs, and I want to mention two of those incorrect proofs because they also led to interesting developments in graph theory. So the one of the first false proofs, let me call this false proof one, was in 1879 by a guy called Alfred Kempe. And his proof was shown to be incorrect. In 1890, by Percy Heywood. However, in the process, Heywood was able to prove the five-color theorem. So instead of saying that we can use four colors, he was able to show that five colors always suffice. Okay, and we'll be seeing a proof of that. We might actually see multiple proofs of that, maybe on the assignment and in the lectures. Another important false proof was in 1880, just 1 year later, by Peter Tate. And this was shown to be incorrect again 11 years later. By the very famous Julius Peterson. The namesake for the Peterson graph. Okay. And interestingly, Heywood and Peterson both The most famous graphs in graph theory are both named after these people, the Peterson graph and the bipartite analog of the Peterson graph called the Heywood graph. Okay, so I don't know. Interesting coincidence. Good. I'll tell you a bit more about the Peterson graph later and how it is related to Tate's incorrect proof. That being said, Tate's proof approach was still valid, although the proof was incorrect. The approach was only invalidated in 1946 by Bill Tutt, who showed that this approach actually cannot be used to prove the four-color theorem. So the approach was shown to be invalid. In 1946. By Bill Tutt. I'll talk a bit more about this in the next lecture. For the rest of today's lecture, I want to focus on Heywood, the five-color theorem. I don't know if you'll be able to prove it today, probably not, but we will still discuss it a bit more, and we'll see a proof in the next lecture. Okay? Good. So that's all I want to tell you about the history for now. All right. So let's go back to the four-color theorem. And now we are going to look at the vertex version. Okay. So it says that every planar graph is four vertex colorable. Now, notice that if you want to show that a graph is four vertex colorable, you can also keep adding edges to it, so long as you keep it planar, right? Because if you can color a super graph of the given graph by adding edges, then that coloring is also a valid or a proper coloring of the original graph, because adding more edges only introduces more constraints. It just tells you that these two vertices also need to have distinct colors. So if you remove those edges, you still have a proper coloring of the remaining graph. Okay? So, quick observation. If H is a subgraph of G, then any proper vertex coloring of G induces a proper vertex coloring of H. Okay, by throwing away edges, or for that matter, even vertices, you don't impose any new constraints. So the coloring that was proper remains a proper coloring. Okay, so that means that if I give you a planar graph, you can keep adding more edges to it and make it a maximal planar graph, which means that adding any more edges will make it non-planar. And you can just color the maximal planar graph to get a coloring of the original graph, to get a proper coloring of the original graph. Okay, so this implies that it suffices to prove the four color conjecture for maximal planar graphs. Okay. And what are maximal planar graphs? Also, we don't care about, well, we already don't care about loops, because if you have loops, then you cannot color the graph, right? So, but we also don't care about multiple edges, because if you have multiple edges, then you're not getting any additional information. So, for the most part, let's not even worry about graphs with multiple edges and loops, okay? So, when it comes to coloring, we restrict ourselves to simple graphs. Okay. So that means that I can keep adding edges so long as I have a planar graph, and then I can prove the result for the resulting graph, right? And what are maximal planar graphs? They are exactly triangulations. We have defined before what triangulations are. Triangulations are those plane graphs where each face is bounded by a 3-cycle. Okay, or maybe if I don't want to say cycle, the degree of each face is 3. Okay. And you can show that triangulations are 3 connected. In fact, triangulations will have M equal to 3n minus 6, the maximum number of edges possible, and they are 3 connected. Except for the triangle, because it has just 3 vertices, and for 3 connected, you need 4 vertices. So long as the number of vertices is at least 4. Okay? So, in other words, we just need to prove the statement for 3 connected triangulations. Okay. Good. So, we'll be using this observation in the next lecture. Whenever we prove a result, we will generally be assuming that we have a maximal planar graph, and proving it for that will prove it for all planar graphs. Okay, good. So, all right. So, for the rest of this lecture, I just want to convince you that 6 colors are enough. And in the next lecture, we will show that five colors are enough. Okay. So, proposition, you can call it the six color theorem, although I think Bondi Murthy, they don't even prove it explicitly. It says that every loopless planar graph is six vertex colorable. Okay, this turns out to be really easy. Does anybody see a proof of this? Is there anything we have discussed so far that would easily prove this result? Why does six colors suffice? Okay, so since not, I assume you haven't seen this, so I'll give you a hint. The answer is here. In any planar graph, we know that the number of edges is upper bounded by 3n minus 6, where n is the number of vertices. Okay, this implies, I think I already wrote down this corollary. It's 10.22. Every simple planar graph has a vertex of degree at most 5. Okay. So I want to use this fact to prove that six colors are always enough to color any planar graph. Does anybody see it? How we can use this to prove the result? So let's say G is your planar graph. Okay. Well, there is a vertex of degree at most 5. So let's just make a drawing. So there is some vertex whose degree is at most 5. I claim that now I should be able to, exactly. Anand says we can use induction, right? So let's do that. Let us use induction on the number of vertices and let's look at this graph G minus V. By induction, this graph can be colored using six colors. And now I put this vertex back into the picture. Its neighbors, well, there are at most 5 neighbors. They can use at most 5 colors. And so there is a sixth color which is still available. Done, right? So the proof is by induction on the number of vertices of the graph. Let V be a vertex of degree at most 5. Color G minus V by induction, or by the induction hypothesis, G minus V is colorable. Proper color, if you like, right? And well, this graph satisfies the induction hypothesis because any subgraph of a planar graph is also planar, right? So it is a planar graph. Good. You can color it with six colors. And now the neighbors of V use Windows security, leave me alone. The neighbors of V use at most 5 colors. So we make color V using the remaining color. And that's it. You might ask, what's the base case of your induction? All graphs with with at most 6 vertices. That's your base case, if you like, right? All graphs with at most 6 vertices can be colored with 6 colors. And then you just proceed by induction, right? So that proves the 6 color proposition. Okay. But how do we prove that 5 colors suffice? Well, the problem is a planar graph may not have vertices of degree at most 4. If you could prove somehow that every simple planar graph has a vertex of degree at most 4, then you would be able to prove the 5 color theorem. Unfortunately, there are simple planar graphs that do not have any vertices of degree 4 or less. So, there are planar graphs in which each vertex has degree at least 5. I should add simple planar graphs just to be clear. And so, this approach cannot be used to prove the 5 color theorem. However, one of the main contributions of Heywood in this context, although Heywood did a lot of other things, I suppose, was to prove the 5 color theorem. He found a flaw in Alfred Kempe's proof, and he was able to recover something useful from that, which was a proof of the 5 color theorem. Not only that, Heywood's proof, Heywood's and Kempe's contributions were actually useful even in getting a proof of the 4 color theorem, which we will not be discussing in this course, because there is no proof of the 4 color theorem which can actually be covered in a course. All of the proofs of the 4 color theorem, they rely on computations, because they have some hundreds of cases to analyze, and that's no fun, right? So even today, people, there are graph theorists who would still like to find a simpler proof of the 4 color theorem that could be taught in a course on graph theory. But yes, we are not there yet. Okay, so we will prove the 5 color theorem in the next lecture. And after that, we will move on to Tate's contribution and see an equivalent way of stating the 4 color conjecture using edge colorings. So rather than vertex and face colorings, there is a way to look at it using edge colorings. And that was one of the ways people started studying edge colorings and matchings in graphs, which is going to be which are going to be our next 2 modules in the course. Okay, so we will do this in the next lecture, and we will begin with proving the 5 color theorem. Okay. So regarding the module coloring, vertex colorings, what we are doing right now is these 2 sections of the text. And the plan that I have in mind is to, let's see, I want to cover sections 14.1, perhaps 14.4. And I'm not too sure about the last 2, 14.5 and 15.3. But I'm really not sure. This is my first time. Okay, so there's some problem here. 14.5 and 15.3. But yeah, coloring vertices is Definitely not my forte. So I'm mostly I've been learning the material or relearning the material in order to present it. The last time I saw these things was in my master's and PhD. I specialize in matchings. Good. Any questions or concerns? Okay. So is everything clear? You might want to try proving this on your own, that triangulations on at least four vertices are three connected graphs. That might be something you want to do yourself before the next lecture. Okay. So I'll be putting out the next assignment number three, by tomorrow. Yeah, I'll do it tomorrow. And you will have quite some time to do it, probably until the 7th of April, because someone requested that they would like more time as they were going on a holiday on the during the break. So I'll be giving you time until 7th of April. Good. And also, I've announced on Piazza that for the writing exercise, the deadline has been extended from the 21st to the 26th. So you have 5 more days. But please get started on that because it's not an easy writing exercise. There is a lot to write. And since this may be your first time writing such a proof, it will take you a few iterations to get a good write-up. Okay, so I'll stop recording, but I'm still here for another 4 or 5 minutes in case there are any questions.